our evening offering, and we have an opportunity to worship in our time of giving. Alex, would you pray for us, please?
God, thank you for allowing us to be able to come here and just give Brother Eddie the words to say as he comes up and speaks in your prayer.
Welcome tonight. I hope that everyone is well. We're going to have a corporate time of prayer right now. I want to go through our prayer list and then give you a scriptural thought, and then we'll have this time together. On our prayer list tonight, some needs that have been brought to my attention. We want to remember Ms. Ruby Stallings, who's going to be having surgery on Wednesday. Let's remember her. We'll remember Joe Garner and test results coming back for him. We'll remember Brother Benny McCann. He had knee surgery on Tuesday and is recovering well, doing great. We also want to remember our upcoming elections, both locally and nationally. I ask that you would pray for me. I'm going to be preaching a series of revival meetings in Phillipston, Mississippi, outside of Sidon, Mississippi, which is outside of Greenwood. That's going to be Friday, Saturday, and Sunday. We also want to remember Ms. Shauna Helton, who's having surgery, I believe, on the 4th, on Tuesday. To remember her surgery. We also want to remember Anthony Webb. I got the chance to talk to him this week, and he was saying that if his recovery goes as he's progressed so far, that he may get to go back to work on November the 12th. So let's remember Anthony and his recovery. We also want to pray for our church in terms of unity, protection, and growth. Is there anyone or anything else that we can pray about? Yes, sir, Ethan. All right, we'll pray for Pop. We'll pray for Mr. Ed.
Unspoken
prayer request. How many of those do we have? All right. Anything else? Gene Jones family.
This one. My brother Clark Latham.
Clark Latham. Got his name down here. We couldn't remember his name. Clark Latham. Mr. Larry, did I see your hand up too?
Joel Walker.
Okay. Okay. All right. Is there anyone or anything else?
Pray for the election. Our city and state will go well for the people.
Uh-huh. Pray for the poll workers too. Well, before we make our way down to the altar of the front pew, I want to give you a scriptural thought. In John chapter 16, we have the upper room discourse, or Jesus' farewell address. He knows that he's going to be betrayed. He knows that he's going to be tried, crucified, buried, and he's going to be raised from the dead. He knows that his time with the disciples now is short, just a few hours. So he gives them some needed instruction. And in John chapter 16, verses 23 to 24, he speaks on the topic of prayer. And he tells us something that is really wonderful and overwhelming. And I don't think we consider it as often as we should. He says in verse 23, "In that day, you will not question me about anything. Truly, truly, I say to you, if you ask the Father for anything in my name, he will give it to you. Until now, you have asked for nothing in my name. Ask, and you will receive, so that your joy may be made full." He tells us here that when we go to the Lord in prayer, if we ask in his name, we are granted a hearing with the Father, and in accordance to the Father's will, we will receive our answer. Now, I want you to think about this in two ways. One, that is a great freedom that we have. We can go to the Lord in prayer about anything, and we have an answer. We have an answer through Jesus, and that is because Jesus is Lord. Amen? But there's a flip side to that. I call it the fine print. When we go to the Lord in prayer, we have a hearing because Jesus is the Lord. But he can also speak back to us, can he not? Does he speak back to you in prayer? And because he is Lord, he can give you requests. He can give you commands, things that he demands of you to do. So as we bow to him in prayer, as we take our requests, as we take our needs, remember the freedom that we have to pray to the Lord about anything. But also remember the fact that he is the Lord means there's going to be times, because you are his servant, he's bought you, he owns you, there's going to be times when he says, child, I don't like that in your life. Get rid of it. Child, I've got this for you that I want you to pursue, that I want you to embrace. And because he is the Lord, we are to respond with, yes, sir, we will do it. Right now, will you make your way to the front? Make your way to the altar. Make your way to the front pew. And we will have a season of corporate prayer. Our Father, we come into your presence, and we know with absolute certainty that you grant us a hearing, an audience with you. Father, it is because we come in the name of Jesus Christ, out of your love for your only begotten Son, out of his perfect righteousness that has been applied and imputed to our lives. You hear us, and for you to hear is for you to answer, Lord. Father, I ask as we lift up these needs, these petitions to you, that you would answer in keeping with your will, Father. Lord, remind us tonight that we have the freedom to approach you with anything, but also remind us tonight, Lord, because you are the Lord, you have the right to ask of us. You have the right to issue orders and commands. Father, I pray that you would help us to hear your voice and to respond, Lord, to your commands with submission. Tonight, Lord, I wish to pray for Ms. Ruby and her upcoming surgery. Lord, I pray that you would calm any kind of nervousness, Then, Father, I pray that you might be with her surgeon and nurses, that you would give them wisdom and skill in what they do, and let that surgery, Lord, go smoothly with no complications. Father, I pray for Joe as he awaits these test results. I pray for those who are going to be looking at the test results and making a diagnosis. Father, give them skill, give them insight into what is going on. And Lord, I pray that whatever treatment they prescribe, that it would have its intended effect. Father, I lift up Brother Beanie to you. We praise you, Father, that his surgery went well. We praise you that he is having a good recovery. I ask, Father, that you would put your hand upon him and grant him a full and speedy recovery, Lord. Father, we also wish to pray for the upcoming elections, Father. Lord, we pray that the right candidates would be elected, Father, and that they would bring about change. Change in our community, change in our nation that pleases you and that is much needed. Father, I wish to pray for the revival services where I'm going to be preaching. Lord, I ask that you would anoint me. Father, I ask that your Holy Spirit would move among that church. I pray that we would see many believers rededicate themselves to you. And Lord, I pray for the lost who are going to be there, that they would be brought to a saving knowledge of Christ. Lord, I pray for my church. I pray for Second Baptist. I love this church. I love the families, Lord. Father, I ask that you would bless our church in a special way. Grant us unity, peace, and harmony. Protect us, Lord, from the enemy within, our sin nature, and the enemy without, Satan. And Lord, we pray that you would grow our church. We pray that you would grow us, Lord, first of all, in our intimacy and knowledge of you, and then also, Lord, in our numbers. Lord, we also wish to lift up Shauna Helton and her surgery on November the 4th. Lord, it is a major surgery. We ask that you would be with her family. We ask that you would be with her doctors and guide them, Lord, and give them skill in what they do. Father, I lift up Anthony Webb to you. Lord, I pray that you would put your hand upon his burns, upon that place where that skin graft is, and that you would heal his body and he would get to go back to work soon, Father. Lord, I lift Mr. Ed Phillips up to you. Lord, I pray that you would draw him close to you and that you would bless him in a special way. Father, I lift up all of the unspoken prayer requests. Lord, there were so many hands that are raised. Lord, these needs are unknown to us, but known perfectly to you, Father. Lord, step into each and every situation. Be glorified, Father, by the answers, by the help that you bring. Father, I pray for Gene Jones, I pray for Clark Latham, and I pray for Joel Walker, Lord. They are going through different physical ailments. Lord, I pray that you would touch them and that you might bring healing to their bodies. Lord, we ask that you would bless the remainder of our services. We want to welcome you. We want to invite you, Lord, to move among us, to touch our hearts, and to change us, Lord. Change us from who we are right now. And Lord, conform us to the blessed image of your Son, Jesus Christ. And it's in his name that I pray and ask this. Amen.
Hymn number 530, what a beautiful song. Written by George Beverly Shea, I'd rather have Jesus. Let's sing it together.
Thank you.
Good evening and welcome back. Tonight, we're going to continue our series in the book of Genesis. So take your Bible and open it to the first book of the Bible, the book of Genesis. Did y'all know that this week we're having elections? Unless you've been under a rock or in a hole, you know that we are having elections. We are having local elections, and then we're also having national elections as well, the midterm elections, as they call them. And you have different candidates who are presenting themselves. Maybe you've seen or heard one in person. Perhaps you've read an article about them in the paper or on the internet. Or maybe you've watched an interview with one on television or a debate or what have you. But with each candidate, you see that they have a plan. They have a strategy. They have a method. They are going to fix the problems that we're having in our society, in our community. They're going to cure the ailments of our country. Now, some of the things they say may work. Some of the changes that they wish to bring are good, but can I offer you an opinion? The change that must be wrought in our country must be spiritual. The other things that we face, the deplorable condition of our nation and of our community, are of a spiritual nature, and they must be addressed spiritually. If I had to boil down the spiritual problem confronting our country, confronting our civilization, confronting our society, if I had to boil this spiritual problem down to one thing, to its essence, I would say this: the problem with our society is a lack of godly men. The problem with our society is a lack of godly daddies, godly leaders who will shoulder the responsibility, who will shoulder the role that God has given them when He made them. Tonight, I want to talk to you about godly daddies. The title of this message is When Father Becomes a Godly Daddy. And before I go into the message, before I read a passage or anything, I want to preface it with these remarks. I'm not beating up on men tonight. No, not beating up on you. I want to give you some positive things to think about. I want to give you some positive things to consider so that you and I'm a father as well, so that we might change, so that we might be transformed and bring God more glory by being that man that He's called us to be. If you brought your Bible, I want to share with you just two verses tonight. The book of Genesis, chapter 4. And I want you to look with me at verses 25 to 26. Now, some of your Bibles are going to show this is inclusive with, including with Genesis 5. I'm going to take these two verses independently, and we're going to look at Genesis 5 the next time that I preach in the book of Genesis. So let's look at these two verses now. We're told Adam had relations with his wife again, and she gave birth to a son and named him Seth. For she said, God has appointed me another offspring in place of Abel, for Cain killed him. To Seth, to him also a son was born, and he called his name Enosh. Then men began to call upon the name of the Lord. May God add his blessing to the reading of his holy inspired word tonight. I'm going to ask if you would join me in prayer. Our Father, as we come before you and we survey, Lord, the wreckage, the depravity of our society, Father, we can talk about the many causes. We can talk about the many reasons, the many factors involved. But Lord, we know that first and foremost, the things that are going on in our country and our community are the results of a spiritual problem. And Father, we know that a major answer to that is going to be when fathers become daddies and when men step up to be men of God. Lord, I want to pray for myself. I want to pray for every man in here tonight. Lord, you have given us a role. You have given us a responsibility. It is an important responsibility. It is an influential responsibility. Father, I pray tonight that all of us, myself included, would recognize the importance of it and act accordingly. And Father, I pray that as we step up, the next generation would be impacted. Our church would be impacted. Our community would be impacted. Our families would be impacted. But first and foremost, that you would be glorified. Father, I ask tonight as I proclaim your word that you would strengthen me, that you would give me, Lord, that last bit of energy to finish my responsibilities for this day. Lord, anoint me. Grant me the words to say. Give me liberty and authority with which to preach. And Lord, I pray that you would help us to submit to the truth of your word, that you would open our minds to receive it and to understand it. And what we hear tonight, what we know to be true, that we would obey it immediately and carry it out in our lives, Father. And I ask this in Jesus' name and for his sake. Amen. As we've gone through the book of Genesis, you've heard me say over and over again that the book of Genesis is the book of origins. And it is a foundational book to develop a Christian worldview. In the book of Genesis, we see a variety of issues. We see the formation of the universe, the heavens and the earth. We see the creation of man. We see the entrance of sin into the world. But we also see something else. It's something subtle. But you pick up on it as you read through it. Within the book of Genesis, you see a series of what commentators call cycles. You will see a cycle of sin, judgment, I'm running out of space. There we go, and new beginning. Sin, judgment, and new beginning. So far, we have seen two of those cycles. We see the creation of Adam and Eve. They were created, they were formed, they were placed in the Garden of Eden. They had perfect fellowship. They lived in perfect harmony and communion with God. Their fellowship with him was contingent on obedience. They were to do two things. God told them to cultivate the garden and not to eat from the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. That's what he told them. Sin entered into the world. Satan tempted them and they succumbed to that sin. Sin entered into the world. There was judgment upon them. They were cast out of the Garden of Eden. Their relationship with God, their perfect communion, was severed. Then we see a new beginning. They're outside of the Garden of Eden now, and they have two children, Cain and Abel. A bright and glorious hope. They've taught them about God. Both of the boys approach God in worship, but then there's a problem, isn't it? Sin rears its ugly head again. Cain tried to approach God in his own method, by his own way. He was in rebellion. He was in sin. God reasons with him logically. He shows great mercy. He shows great patience. Cain refuses to listen. He goes further into his rebellion, further into his sin. And the result is the murder of Abel and the judgment upon Cain and the judgment upon his line. We see that the descendants of Cain, they go further, further away from God and further into their sin. In the last two verses of Genesis 4, we see the cycle begin again. There's a new beginning, a new hope. Adam and Eve, they have another child whose name is Seth. Seth begins a long line of godly descendants. This happened when Seth became a father. Seth stepped up and became a godly daddy, became committed to obeying God. I want you to look with me tonight at this account, at these two verses, and I want to talk to you just about some things to consider in order to become a godly daddy, a man that pleases the Lord. The first thing that I want to note with you is what I call the tragedy. The tragedy. I'm going to testify here about men. Ladies, I'm sure you already know this, but men, sometimes we don't. Men are prideful, hard-headed, and obstinate. I'm getting these looks from the men, ladies, like, you betrayed us. How could you? What's the truth? We are prideful, we are hard-headed, and we are obstinate. We know what's best. Our way is the right way, is it not? And many, many times we do not want to listen to God. Many, many times we do not want to submit to His commands. And so you know what the Lord will often do? He will allow a tragedy to come into our lives, to get our attention, and change us. Folks, it's true. A lady cannot change a man. Only God can change a man, change his life. And God will often use a tragedy to do so. He did it in the family of Adam, beginning with Seth. Let me share with you the tragedy that happened to his life and how it applies to us and how God will use it. First, I want you to note with me the nature of the tragedy in the first family. I want you to look with me at verse 26 of our passage. And I want you to note just the last sentence. Then men began to call upon the name of the Lord. Then, what does that mean? It means at that time, men began to call upon the name of the Lord. Men began to worship the one true and living God. At what time? What is the then in question? What this means is after the first homicide, after the murder in the first family, then men began to call upon the name of the Lord to do it on a regular, consistent basis to worship the one true and living God. So we see the first tragedy that took place in the family. Did you see, you remember what it was? Let me review it with you in case you were not here or you have forgotten. Remember Cain? Remember Abel? Both of them presented a sacrifice unto the Lord. Cain did it in the wrong way. It was the wrong motivation. It was not the way that God prescribed. God seeks to reason with him, to get him to confess, to get him to turn from his sin. He refuses to listen. He refuses to heed. He goes further into sin, and the result is the world's first murder, the first homicide. Now, murder is bad always, right? Murder's not good. Can we agree on that? But it's even worse when it is the murder of a family member. Somebody you grew up with. Think of this. Cain murders Abel. They slept by one another. Grew up together. Ate meals at the same table. They're like most brothers. They look like each other. And Cain killed him. Premeditated murder. A very heinous and terrible crime. And a great and terrible tragedy to that family. That was the nature of the tragedy. Now I want to talk to you about the use of it. The use of that tragedy. I need to square one thing away. Did God cause that tragedy? No. God is not the author of sin, of temptation. He is not the author of that. Who is responsible for that tragedy? They were. Who is responsible for sin? We are. This is not my opinion. This is the testimony of the Word of God. The book of James says in James chapter 1, verses 13 to 16, he says this, "Let no one say when he's tempted, I am being tempted by God. For God cannot be tempted by evil, and he himself does not tempt anyone. But each one is tempted when he is carried away and enticed by his own lust. Then when lust has conceived, it gives birth to sin. And when sin is accomplished, it brings forth death. Do not be deceived, my beloved brethren." He says, don't you dare lay sin and temptation at the feet of God. We are responsible because we have a sinful, depraved nature within. Who was responsible for that tragedy? Who was responsible for that first murder? Cain was, because of his sin, because of his wickedness. Now that we've got that out of the way, though, let me say this. God did not cause this, but he did use it. He did use it redemptively. He did use it for his glory. He did use it to bring change in the first family. I've taught you this before, and I want to remind you of something. In Scripture, as you interpret it, as you study it, sequence is very, very important. I've hit on this again. Let me say it to you and remind you. Look what it says in verse 26. Then men began to call upon the name of the Lord. This was after that first homicide, after that first murder. What can we deduce from this? God used that tragedy in the family of Adam to get their attention. It made a big impact on Seth. When he became a father, when he saw Enosh, his little boy, he said, I can't let happen to Enosh and my family what happened to Cain and Abel. Things have got to be different. So what did he do? He started to lead his family in the worship of the true God. He started to shoulder his God-given role and responsibility. He started to bring up his children, who in turn brought up their children in the fear of the Lord. Now let's step back and let us apply this right now. God still does not cause tragedy. He is not the author of sin. Do not lay that at his doorstep. But with that said, I want you to understand this. God will use the tragedies of our lives redemptively. God will use the tragedies within our families, the hurts, to get our attention, to bring transformation and change. I've seen it. I've seen it personally in my own family. It was not until my parents were on the brink of divorce that my dad was saved and that my dad shouldered the responsibility of leading his family. I've seen it in the ministry. I've seen sickness, death, strife, division, something painful and hard, something terrible. I've seen God take it and use it to break a man and get their attention and open their eyes to what they have and what they are in danger of losing and the responsibility that the Lord has entrusted to them. I've seen it happen over and over again. But I want to tell you men here tonight, do not let it come to that. If at all possible, don't let it be a tragedy, the thing that brings you to God. Come of your own will. Come of your own volition. Come and accept your responsibility to be a man of God, to be a daddy that teaches their children about the Lord. We see the tragedy. Now I want to share with you something else. I want to share with you the template. The template of it. Maybe you're thinking right now, Brother Randy, I see exactly what you're talking about. The Holy Spirit is pricking my life. I see that I need to change. I see that I need to be a man of God. I see that I need to be a godly daddy. How do I do it? How does it accomplish? How can I yield to the Lord and change me? We see it in verses 25 and 26. Look at verse 26 again. Look at the last part of the verse. I've read it before. You're going to hear it several more times before we close this message. Then men began to call upon the name of the Lord. What does that sentence mean? It means at that time, men began to worship God. What does it mean to worship God? It means to glorify Him. It means that He is worthy of tribute, worthy of worship. It means to give God His due in every single aspect of our lives, to give Him His due, to give Him His glory. And from verse 26, we can deduce a great truth. I want you all to hear me, men and women, hear me. This is so important. One of God's greatest avenues to change us is worship. Do you hear me? One of the greatest avenues, one of the greatest keys to being transformed from who you are, from sinful self, and being conformed to the image of God and Jesus, is by worshiping Him, by seeking to give Him glory every part of your life. How do you do that? Well, note the template that we're given in these two verses. First, we see in this template what I call the regularity of the worship. Hebrew scholars, men that know a lot more about Hebrew than I can ever know, they say that this sentence, then men began to call upon the name of the Lord, they say that in the Hebrew, it implies that at that time, men began to approach God in worship with their families with regularity. They were coming before God on a regular, consistent basis at that time. And this is what changed Adam's family, his line through Seth. This is what brought about a succession, generation after generation, of godly men that we're going to see in Genesis 5. It was this fact that they came together and they worshiped God on a regular, consistent basis. And as they did that, God changed them. God transformed them. Now, how does that apply to us tonight? What does regularity of worship mean? Men, I want you to hear me. You should be worshiping God in three ways on a consistent basis, on a regular basis. One, you should be worshiping God privately every day. Not a day should go by when you do not step away from the world and enter the presence of God and give Him His due. Give Him His due in prayer. Give Him His due in the study of His Word. Give Him His due in spending sweet time of fellowship with Him. Not a day should go by. There should be private worship, but then there should be family worship. You are the spiritual leader of your family. God has entrusted that role to you. And you are to teach your family. And you are to lead your family in worship. Again, I would tell you this, not a day should go by, as you were able, that you do not gather together your spouse and your children, and you enter the presence of the Lord together, and you pray, and you read the Word, and you worship. Now, there's bunches of resources on how to do that. I'll be glad to talk with you about it. The important thing is that you do it as a family. There's private worship, there's family worship, but then there's corporate, public worship. That's what we're doing right now. At Second Baptist, we have regular set time for us to come together as the body of Christ to worship the Lord. You need to be a part of that. Most men, let me rephrase that. Not most men, some men. I don't want to lump us all into one category. They're creasters. You know what a creaster is? A creaster is someone that comes to church on Christmas and Easter. A creaster. Some men are creasters. If you want to be changed, if you want to become that godly man, that godly daddy, that's got to go out the window. And you've got to come to the Lord publicly on a regular, consistent basis. We see the regularity of the worship. Look at another thing in this template. We see not only the regularity of the worship, we see the leadership of the worship. Again, look at verse 26 and look at that last sentence. It says, then men began to call upon the name of the Lord. Told you that this means worship. It means regularity, consistency in worship. Notice the word men there. Now, a lot of these Hebrew scholars that know so much more than I do, they say that men is used in a broad, general, inclusive way. That by this, it means that all people, both men and women, were coming on a consistent basis and worshiping God. I think that is certainly there in the text. I think that is certainly true. That is certainly a good thing. That's something that needs to happen, ladies. But I also think that it says men right there. And we can work with some grammar. We can do this. We can do that. But it says men right there. And it implies the leadership role of worship held by men. Now understand something. God has made us man and women. He's made us. We are equal. We're both created in His image. But He has given us different roles. And a part of the man's role, a part of his responsibility, is to lead his family. He is the spiritual leader of his household. He is to lead in worship. Men, that's what God has called you to do. That's what He has designed you to do. If you're going to be a man of God, if you're going to be a godly daddy, you've got to lead as Christ compels you to lead. Through this type of worship, regular worship, and by us leading in that way, let me tell you what God is going to do to your life. Change you. Transform you. Brother Terry and I were talking about this before the service. It's a profound thing to me. How God takes something so simple. Prayer. Worship. And in that, changes us. I've experienced that, have you? The more I pray, the more I worship, the better I am. The more different I am, the more Randy dies, and the more Christ rules and reigns over him. I don't understand it. I can't stand up here and say, here's how it happens. It does, though. When you worship, when you pray, when you do it consistently, that is the avenue. That is the mode that God uses. So tonight we've seen the tragedy. We've seen the template. Now I want you to see the long-term effects. The long-term effect. It almost was an alliterated outline. Except for the third point. The long-term effects. Now, men, why should you want to become a man of God? Why should you seek to be a godly daddy? Here's the most basic answer. God tells you you need to be. That ought to settle it. That ought to finish it. You need to be my man. You need to be a godly father. We should say, yes, sir, Lord. That's it. But I tell you, there's another reason as well. We see this in chapter 5. Look at chapter 5 with me. I'm not going to read all of this. I heard this is a genealogy. Chapter 5. I had an Old Testament professor, I kid you not, he said if you needed a cure for insomnia, read the genealogy sections of the Bible. The genealogical sections, these are often the ones that we go through really fast, don't we? To get to the good stuff, you know? We go through it really, really, really fast. But the genealogies are important. Do you know what this genealogy is doing right here? Chapter 5 is transitional. The genealogy of chapter 5 is setting the stage for the emergence of Noah. Setting the stage. It is showing these long-term effects of one man stepping up and leading his family in godliness. It starts with Seth, after the murder of Cain and Abel, saying, this can't happen again. I've got to lead my family in godliness. It starts with him. And you see generation after generation after generation after generation walking with the Lord. And then it culminates with Noah. and that man, the only family that survived the judgment, the long-term effects. What are the long-term effects that we see in Genesis 5? Well, first we see a line of godly men. A line of godly men. We're going to look at this more later on. But chapter 5 is a contrast. This shows the line of Adam through Seth, and it's contrasting the line of Adam through Cain. When you look at chapter 4, when you look at Cain's descendants, you see further and further that journey into ungodliness, that journey into sin. Contrast it with Genesis 5. You see a line of godly men walking with the Lord, committed to His ways. That line of godly men started with one daddy, Seth. When Seth got Enosh, when Enosh was born, then men began to call upon the name of the Lord. Seth made a decision. The things of the past are not going to happen again. We will worship God regularly. And the result of that was a line of godly men. Second, the long-term effects. Also, generations of purposeful use. Generations of purposeful use. I don't have time to go into all this. We're going to look at it again on another occasion, look at chapter 5 in particular. But I want to call your attention to two men that are mentioned here, Enoch and Noah. Enoch and Noah are presented to us in Genesis 5. In the New Testament books of Hebrews and Jude, Enoch and Noah are talked about. They are spoken of as prophets and preachers of righteousness. Men of God that the Lord used. They are one but many who were used in chapter 5 to serve the Lord. And again, I'd say this, it started with one guy. Started with Seth. Saying, I'm gonna leave my family. I'm going to be a man of God. And I'm going to bring up my children to love the Lord. And you see generation after generation walking with the Lord and in service to Him. Men, I'll tell you this tonight, as I was thinking about this passage this week, I was thinking about my own daughter. My life has been changed for the better by that little girl. I just can't imagine life without her. I was thinking about her. And I was walking with her one day this afternoon, one afternoon this week. And as I was doing, I was thinking about her future and what I wanted for her. And I started throwing out the things like we all do. Wonder where she's going to go to school. Wonder where she's going to go. Wonder what career path she's going to take. And going through all those things. And then it hit me. It's the Holy Spirit convicting me. Those things are not as important. What is important that she knows the Lord. What is important is that she serves Him regardless of where she is, regardless of what vocation she goes into. What is important is that she serves God. Do you want that for your family? Do you want that for your children? We should. We should desire it. And we should do what we can, our part, to bring it about. Right now, we're going to have a time of decision. And I want this to be a two-part time. Two-part decision. Number one, are you a daddy? And are you in need of help? Are you struggling to be a man of God? Are you struggling to be a godly daddy? Then I encourage you to come up here to the altar, to cry out to the Lord, to worship Him. And through the worship, be changed. Through the worship, let God change you into what you need to be. Or maybe you're here tonight and there's a certain man that you want to pray for. You want to pray that he'll become a man of God. You want to pray that he'll become a godly daddy. If so, approach this altar and talk to the Lord of it as we have this time of decision.